Well, welcome to another opportunity to worship online with the Community of Faith of Alamance Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Ron Philibom. As Solomon prays for wisdom, we seek to more deeply know the treasures of faith. In today's gospel, Jesus offers everyday images that reveal to us the reign of God. A tree that becomes a sheltering home, yeast that penetrates and expands, a treasured pearl, and a net that gains a great catch. Even as we seek the riches of God's reign, the great surprise is that God's grace finds us first. So come along with us as we learn and we grow together. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is sure. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and our neighbors. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned. We have hurt our community. We have squandered your blessings. We have hoarded your bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Well, God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. My Lord and God, you direct my life by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world we live in. My Lord and God, help me to listen and learn and grow in service to you. Inspire me through the scriptures and 1 Kings, the Psalms, Romans, and Matthew that we study today, so that I will give and not count the cost, to fight and not to calculate the wounds, to sweat and not to seek for rest, to work deliberately and not to ask for reward, except that of knowing that I am doing your will, Lord. Grant that I may believe in you, call upon you, know you, and serve you. And by your Spirit, give us your wisdom, that we may treasure the life that comes from Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading is from 1 Kings, the 3rd chapter, beginning with the 5th verse. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "O Lord, you have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Although I am only a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the great people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this, your great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this, and God said to him, because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, but you have asked for yourself an understanding to discern what is right. I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm for today is the 119th psalm, and we will read verses 129 through 136. Your decrees are wonderful, therefore I obey them with all my heart. When your word is opened, it gives light, it gives understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant because I long for your commandments. Turn to me and be gracious to me, as you always do to those who love your name. Order my footsteps in your word. Let no iniquity have dominion over me. Rescue me from those who oppress me, and I will keep your commandments. Let your face shine upon your servant and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears because people do not keep your teaching. Our second reading is from the 8th chapter of Romans. It begins with the 26th verse. St. Paul writes, "The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? Who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us? Will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No. And in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." This is the word of God. We are listening, Lord. Our gospel for the day comes to us from the 13th chapter of Matthew, and it begins with the 31st verse. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. "The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches." He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field which someone found and hid. Then, in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. And when it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They asked. They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The gospel of our Lord. Speak to me, dear Jesus. It is so very good to be together with you today and seek the Lord's inspiration through this meditation on God's word. So let us bow our heads and ask a blessing upon it. Lord, we humbly come before you with gratitude to be assembled here in your house. I pray that you will bless the words that I speak from this humble meditation of my heart, so that we will listen and grow together. Amen. Well, when I grew up, heaven was often described as a kingdom that defied human imagination with streets of gold. Although many have tried to give an accurate description, the immensity of God is still beyond the grasp of our understanding. Yet here in our gospel, Jesus shares 5 parables in ways that those who are truly listening can understand, each step closer to what we are to grasp. We could study at length each one, but I'm going to focus on the first. Now, you may remember the 1984 television ad that Wendy's hamburger chain made famous by the actress looking at a competitor's big bun and a meat patty that was the size of a pickle. And the actress growls, "Where's the beef?" The story has it that the director of the commercial wanted this elderly actress, Clara Peller, to say, "Where is all the beef?" But Clara, unfortunately, had emphysema, and that was too hard of a statement for her to say. So, with her limited lung capacity, those long sentences just wasn't in the mix. So, instead, she said, "Where's the beef?" And it stuck. Sometimes in life, I wonder if we judge the value by quantity rather than quality. We could go to a buffet of food, or we can be nourished from a well-crafted, intimate meal with friends. From less, great fulfilling experiences develop. In our gospel, Jesus makes it clear the value of the tree, whose origin comes from such small beginnings, that tiny little seed becomes the tree, so that the birds of the air can come and make nests in its branches. Now, metaphorically speaking, 70 years ago, this community of faith of Alamance Lutheran took a tiny seed of faith to expand and create classrooms to act as branches for others to come and make nests of learning to grow. As people came here and their faith grew, they were able to fly. Those branches are still there, providing a nest for children of God who are victims of human trafficking to find comfort and feel valued. Down the hall is another classroom that serves as a branch for youth to store their costumes for plays, where they are exploring the creative side of their maturing selves. And next to that is a room that serves as a branch to our members, both young and old, who are in need of medical appliances to help them walk. You are providing branches that you may not have recognized in that same way. Jesus uses seed and yeast imagery to describe the unexpected exponential growth of God's kingdom. The seed that grows into a tree that provides safety for birds, and the yeast allows the dough to expand into bread that can feed many. It takes a different perspective, a broadened mind that can grasp what God will do with seed and yeast. Theologian Nancy Quirnis remembers as a child hearing the tip-tap of a cane on the sidewalk. It was an old man in her community who was bent over from the years, his rough and knotted hand purposefully clutched that cane, making that tip-tap sound. But this old man had a particular custom as he roamed the streets of this small town. When he saw a child, he would stop, and then he'd reach into his pocket, and he'd give the child a picture of Jesus. He would put it into the child's hand, and then continue on his way, never speaking a word. What this man did certainly doesn't really seem like a big deal, does it? However, this small act of kindness made a world of difference to Nancy. And over 40 years later, she still has that picture that he gave her. The picture is of Jesus surrounded by a flock of sheep with a river running through the middle of the picture. And on the back of the card, in his shaky handwriting, was Psalm 23. He just wrote Psalm 23. And it wasn't until Nancy was an adult that she realized what this man was doing. You see, in his own way, he was planting tiny seeds of faith in the children on his street. It worked for Nancy. His faithful commitment, she says, helped fashion a stone in the foundation of my own faith. Whoever would have thought that giving a child a picture of Jesus would eventually lead that child to faith? Whoever would have thought that a tiny little seed would produce such a big tree? And for that matter, whoever would have thought that the Messiah would have come from such a small, unlikely town as Nazareth? You see, it is often from small, seemingly inconsequential beginnings that great good emerges. We are not like our first illustration of the Big Bun hamburger chain with hard-to-find value of beef. We are a mighty, nourishing community of faith who has been putting Jesus in the hands of children of God for nearly 100 years. So how can you make sure this happens while you're still here on earth? What will you do when you're done with all you have to make sure that those pictures, those seeds are being put in the hands of those who don't know Jesus as you have? What are new ways you can serve Christ's mission here? I would encourage you to open your hearts and your ears to the Holy Spirit, who is here and ready to help you. Listen. to those answers. Amen. Let us join together in confessing what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. And he ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Confident that God receives our joys and our concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. Almighty God, we pray for the church and all the servants of the gospel. Equip rostered and lay ministers to proclaim that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Form confirmands and catechumens into disciples. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Gracious God, we pray for the well-being of creation. Safeguard the environment, Clean polluted rivers and lakes, and preserve the mighty tree and the tiny mustard seed, and send advocates for sustainable practices. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Compassionate God, we pray for the nations. Instill in all who govern the ability to discern between good and evil. Free those who are oppressed and protect those facing danger. Impact those who preach hate and division with the same conviction of the gospel that you did for St. Paul. Inspire us as ambassadors of peace across the world and in our towns and neighborhoods through conversation and advocacy. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Merciful God, we pray for all in any need. Protect those fleeing from war and shelter any who are in poverty. Clothe the naked, soothe all who grieve or simply need to feel your presence as they endure a situation in their lives, especially Shane, Carolyn, Hugh, Malachi, Billy, Martha, Blake, Jill, Graham, Mari, Sonia, Shanna, Dewey, Christy, Ray and Gwen, Cheryl, Sydney, Terry, Butch, Tommy, Karen, Eric, Steve, Neil and Susan, Betty, Lynn, Annie, Aaron, Bernie and Ann, Brian, Braden, Bob, Carl and June, Dean, Easton, Ivan, Haley, Jeffrey, Jerry, Jeremy and Jonathan, Joan, Cadence, Carissa, Kenneth, Lynn and Tara, Michelle, Philip and Stanley. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Holy God, we pray for this congregation, both those gathered today and those absent from our assembly. Grant safety to travelers and refreshment and safety for children attending summer camps or community programs. Give direction to any experiencing life transitions. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Lord, speak to us as we build new experiences for our kids and families to learn and grow in faith in you. We lift up the following: Aaron, Amelia, Angus, Austin, Carly, Clayton, Cora Ann, Creston, Daisy, Daniel, Eleanor, Eli, Ella, Ellie, Emma, Greg, Hunter, JJ, James, Jarrett, Jessica, Joan, John, Josie May, Kaya, Katie Rose, Leanne, Layton, Lindsay, Lily, Lizzie, Luke, Marilyn, Max, Megan, Molly, Noah, Owen, Paige, Sam, Sarah, Sarah Joe, Sophie, Cyan, Tabitha, and Tustin. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, we give thanks for your saints who now rest from their labors. Inspire us by their witness to treasure the gospel and continually nourish us with your grace. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We thank you for the opportunity to come to you at all times, to have conversation with you as we seek to follow you with sincerity. Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, including those we name out loud or silently within our own hearts. We lift these prayers and our commitment to serving you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. receive the blessing. The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you now and to the end of the age. And may the Lord watch over your going out and your coming in from this time forth forevermore. Amen. Now go in peace and be inspired by the Holy Spirit to be sent into your communities to serve others with compassion and generosity. Well, thank you for joining us for another online worship opportunity from the Community of Faith of Alamance Lutheran Church, where all are welcome to come, however you are, and everyone will know your name. I'm Pastor Ron. We'll see you again next week to learn and grow together.